First of all, I think that we are doing quite okay. When Gautama Sakyamuni first started, he had only four people. We had five here, so we are doing quite okay. Well, today we're going to be talking about Yogacara Buddhism and the introduction of Asanga and Vasubandhu, as well as Hsuan Tsang. Now, I just want to say that I'm glad that we are able to do this because Hsuan Tsang is really a very important person. He's the first, well, he's not the first foreign student that the Chinese has, but he certainly is the most famous foreign student, well, the student who studied abroad. And he went to India from China during the Tang dynasty. And what you're looking at here is the pagoda, the Big Goose Pagoda. Maybe we can just focus on this, and then what we'll do is what I'm going to try to do is give you a very brief a rundown of Hsuan Tsang's travel to the West, and then we'll talk a little bit about Yogacara Buddhism. I felt that I have to talk a little bit about the travel because Hsuan Tsang, the monk from the Tang Dynasty, is such a well-known figure that everybody must have heard of the journey to the West, or better known as the Monkey King, and which is a mythical account of his travels. Indeed, there was a person, Hsuan Tsang, and indeed he has traveled to the West, and after 18 years came back to China and brought back a whole bunch of Buddhist scriptures. To be exact, I think it is 557 volumes of Buddhist scriptures. And he stored them in this place. This is the Big Goose Pagoda. It still exists in Xi'an, which was called Chang'an in that time. Can we go to the next one? Right now, the scriptures are all gone, of course, because about 200 years after he came back, Hsuan Tsang came back, there was an anti-Buddhist movement in which most of the Buddhist books, especially the Yogacara Buddhism books, were burned. And so he was able to translate only about 75 volumes of the 657. And then they were all gone. And it took quite a few hundred years until the end of the Qing Dynasty, when some Chinese scholar rediscovered the Yogacara Buddhism text from in Japan, in fact. And they brought that back to China and rekindle the study of Yogacara Buddhism. So Yogacara Buddhism lay dormant for a long time, and then it was rediscovered and renaissance, and so to speak. And so this is a picture of Hsuan Tsang. It's a pretty popular picture, carrying all these scriptures back, I guess. Now, certainly it's not like that when he came back, because he came back with a big entourage, and there were elephants and camels and stuff like that to carry all the hundreds of volumes of scriptures back. Let's go to the next one. But also, when you look at a picture like this, for example, I would advise you not to think too much that this was actually what he looked like, because I'm sure that he looked quite different from that. This is a map of modern Xi'an. You can see that, for example, over here, that's the war city. And the Big Goose Pagoda is right over there. And at that time in the Tang Dynasty, it was not allowed, people were not allowed to go out to other countries. And so despite his application for visas, you know, many, many times, he was never allowed to, you know, to go. And until one year, he is quite a remarkable person, and that's why I say that I have to talk a little bit about him. Because while he was waiting, he learned all the languages of the West. There are many, many little countries in the West. And so Chang'an at that time was such a capital that a lot of people congregated, especially the merchants. You can get all kinds of wares from all over the world, as far away as Rome. And so he was able to get access to these people, and he studied the languages. And by the time famine struck one year, they had to open up the gate and let everybody go. And he mingled together with the refugees, and he went west. And it took him a long time you have to read a book called The Travel to the West of the Great Tang. It's called, in Chinese, it's called Da Tang Si Yu Ji, Dai Tong Sai Wei Ge. It's a very important travelogue, because it's very accurately recorded all his travel, all the places that he has been to, etc. This is Jia Yu Guan. It's the last frontier of China at that time. And he went over there, and then he was stopped by the general guarding the frontier. But because there was a law, you know, not allowing anybody to go. So the general was very impressed by what he said, because he said, "I will never take one step east until I get the scriptures back from India." So he let him go, but he convinced him to take some people with him and to exchange his horse with an old horse. Okay, next. So he was able to leave that and, stocked up and left. Now this is a picture of the desert, the same desert that Hsuan Tsang has traveled. But this picture was taken of one of the great British explorer, Otto Stein. Otto Stein followed the description that is contained in the book that I just mentioned, and rediscovered, because all the old cities, they were all gone. They were all buried in the sand. Nobody knows where they were. He read those books, he calculated all of those descriptions, and he found a lot of the lost cities, and he was able to transport tons of relics back to the British Museum. At the British Museum, for example, there is the first edition of the Diamond Sutra. That was the sutra that was printed by, it's like a Gutenberg printing, but it was much, much earlier than Gutenberg, and many, many relics. So anyway, I just want to show you that. But it certainly talked about the accuracy of his writing. I think it's the other way around. So anyway, I'm going to try to make it fast, because I don't want to spend the whole time talking about his travel. It should be the other way around. This is the top, right. This is just a cave that they discovered sometime later. But I use it just to illustrate that these may be the places that Hsuan Tsang have seen, and there will be some pictures of places that he did go and he did see. These are caves, and these are just paintings on the wall about different aspects of the Buddha's life. Anyway, he went to a place called Gaochang, and over there the king of Gaochang was a Buddhist, and he was very excited about the arrival of Hsuan Tsang, and he in fact he wanted to keep him there. But after a month or two, Hsuan Tsang wanted to leave, so finally he imprisoned him in the palace. And then Hsuan Tsang had the first hunger strike in history, because he said, if you don't let me go, I will not eat and I will not drink until I die. So after a long time, finally when he gets weaker and weaker, the king of Gaochang said, all right, I don't want to be such a horrible person, and so I will go to hell. So he let him go, but extracted a promise from Hsuan Tsang that he would return and stay in Gaochang to talk about Buddhism for 3 years after he returned. And he said, fine. And in fact, I'm going to talk about Buddhism for a month now, before I go, whatever I know. Okay, next. So at that time, you see, a lot of the places now that are Muslim right now were in fact Buddhist at that time. And this is the travel of Hsuan Tsang. He started out with Chang'an. He went a long way, Gaochang is around here somewhere. Gaochang is around here somewhere. And then after he left, and the king of Gaochang treated him very well, sent him off with a lot of gifts and letters to 24 kings of the kingdoms around here to introduce him to them and ask them to treat him well, so they escort him so that he can get to India. So places like Kashgar, Samarkand, Tashkent, etc., there were a lot of, right now it's all Muslim country, at that time it was Buddhist. Finally, he came to a place called the travel. You have to read it because it's just incredible travel. He had to climb up all those mountains, in order to reach India. And anyway, he went through the place called, right now it's called Afghanistan. Now, there, he, okay, let's get to the next picture. Okay. Now, this is Bamiyan, a place in Afghanistan, about 60 miles north of Kabul. This is the cliff, there's the hill. Do you see anything strange over there?
Big cave.
Big thing here, right? This is where they carve the statue of Buddha right there. So that when people enter, when they cross over the mountain, the first, and then get down to the plain, the first thing that they see is, are the images of the Buddha. And I want to read you something that a writer Sally Riggins wrote about Hsuan Tsang, a Buddhist pilgrim on the Silk Road, on reaching Afghanistan. This is based on his writing, Hsuan Tsang's writing. Hsuan Tsang's caravan prevailed against the blizzards, mountain guards, and robbers, and finally approached Bamiyan, an oasis town in the center of a long valley, separating the chain of the Hindu Kush from that of the Koi Baba range. The first sight of the Valley of the Great Buddha must have made the weary travelers gasp. Immense cliffs of a soft pastel color, and behind them, indigo peaks dusted with snow. Rising to a height of 20,000 feet, They saw the reddish cliffs in the cold, clear air. As they came closer, they could make out two gigantic statues of the Buddha standing in niches carved in the mountains. Closer still, they saw that two colossal figures were colored and glistening with ornaments. The smaller wore blue, the larger one red, and their faces and hands were gilded. When Hsuan Tsang's caravan first arrived in Bamiyan, the king met the pilgrim and escorted him to his palace. Later, Hsuan Tsang's fellow monks took him on a tour of their valley. Hsuan Tsang reported that there were some tens of Buddhist monasteries and several thousand monks who were adherents of a rare Hinayana school. Now, the Buddhist environment that Hsuan Tsang described that he, when he first encountered, were long gone. And for hundreds of years, however, you know, you don't see those ornaments, you don't see all those color and everything, but this remained until a few years ago. And it was, until a few years ago, it stood as the tallest Buddhas in the world. I want to read you another quote by Milo Beach in a book called Along the Silk Road. That anything from such an ancient period has survived is virtually miraculous. Many of the sites, especially those built of wood or other fragile materials, have simply disintegrated in the harsh climatic conditions. Others were literally buried under the shifting sands of the region's desert landscapes. The recent actions of the ruling Taliban in Afghanistan have demonstrated another threat to the fragility of these remains, however. This is the willful destruction that one group, acting alone, can incur, and the historical and aesthetic loss to all of humanity that can result. The Bamiyan images had been attacked many times in the past, in the 13th century by the armies of Genghis Khan, and in the 17th century by troops of the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb. But they were never destroyed completely. The complete destruction of the images and of related sites and objects throughout Afghanistan is an act of unrivaled cultural brutality, but it also reveals a tragic situation in purely human terms, for the ruin of those material objects were preceded by the destruction of human and cultural value systems, which led to the three acts, these acts of rage. Can we have the next slide? I felt I wanted to comment on that because when I first heard about the Taliban wanted to blow those things up, I was so upset. I wanted to call people's attention to that. Why destroy that? It has been standing for such a long time, and it was a real pity that it was gone. But it also showed you one thing, that times change and things really don't stay the same. A place that was populated by thousands of Buddhist monks were totally gone long time ago. And so anyway, this is the picture of Nalanda Monastery, one of the three most important monasteries in India. And when Hsuan Tsang went over there, it was fully populated. It was he went over there, and the abbot of that monastery was already 106 years old. And he had pain, and he really wanted to die, but he had a dream in which it was revealed that somebody from the East is coming to learn the Dharma from you, so stick around. So he stayed around, and he taught Hsuan Tsang for 3 years, I believe. And this is sort of like the dormitories, the places where it still exists of the Nalanda Monastery. Okay. Let's go to the next one. Now, I mentioned that also because the abbot of Nalanda Monastery is called Silabhadra, and he was a disciple of Dhammapala, and Dhammapala was a disciple of Vasubandhu, one of the monks that we will be talking about, and Vasubandhu and his brother Asanga, they are the ones who established Yogacara Buddhism. And so it has been transmitted through the monastery. You know, the monastery is like a university. They have basically all these people who study things, etc., staying there. Now, I take this because this is the crowning achievement of Hsuan Tsang was when he was in India, was a grand debate. There was a grand debate about the theories and what Buddhism is all about. So it's a debate between the Hinayanas, between the Mahayanas, and between the Hindus and the Jains, etc. In which Hsuan Tsang put forth his argument, and this is his argument. Now, the whole thing was written, of course, in Sanskrit. So I don't know Sanskrit, but this is what it is. Now, do you see something strange between the English translation and the Chinese translation? Anything strange? You don't have to be able to read either. Let me go back. See this? Such a long sentence. Here you only have three characters. So this couldn't possibly be a translation for this, and vice versa. In fact, this is written sort of like along the line of logic, the syllogism that people are more accustomed to. So you say, but the Buddhist logic at that time, which was developed quite a long time ago, was a little bit different. They state their premise, it's reverse, in other words. So this is really this, this is this, this is actually that. Okay, it's the other way around. So it's not exactly logic. I was hoping that Rohit Parikh would be here because he's a logician, and that he would really study this and then let me know about what exactly was going on. Because Hsuan Tsang was using this to basically to state his argument. And for 18 days, nobody can win the debate against him.
It's interesting that I consciousness is really in the beginning, where you put it in the beginning, where this is at the end, this is his conclusion that he reaches, but he doesn't get that.
No, you see, that's the thing. It's not a conclusion. It's the way they state their arguments. The way they state their argument, this is the conclusion that they have. And then, I don't want to go into that because I want Rohit to go into those things, but I'm just saying that I thought that I wanted to let you know about this, to share with you about this, because this is where Hsuan Tsang made his name throughout India. And there were 18 kings in India at that time. And they were so impressed by Hsuan Tsang that they had a grand parade. And let me just, one of the papers that I wanted to read is not here. So I can read you that. But in which it described, a parade for Hsuan Tsang. It was in one of the papers that, just one paper, one sheet missing. One of the king was on the right side of the big elephant. The big elephant, was carrying Hsuan Tsang. On the other side, the king of Assam. On the right side, it was, I think it's King Harsha. you know, at that time. So he was grandly received, and he was really not even, he was really persuaded not to go back to China. Yeah, they want him to stay. They said, why go back to that country when they have no, you know, they don't have any knowledge of Buddhism, etc.
But he was supposed to spread knowledge of Buddhism to China, right?
Right, he was supposed to, yeah. But that is your business. If I'm the king, my business is here, so I wanted you to be here.
Well, he was very well received by the king and the emperor in China, wasn't he?
Yes, 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 so, yes.
Before he went on his trip to India, they had a black parade for him in China.
When he returned. Oh, not when he leave. He would be locked up if they know that he would be leaving. It was only afterwards when he came back.
Oh, that
yeah, and anyway, you know, I want you to take a look at this because this is interesting, because this is what he talked about, eye consciousness. This is what we're going to be talking about, you know, consciousness and objects, you know, and the relationship between, you know, the existence of object and eye consciousness and, you know, that kind of thing. Can we? So, okay. Oh, well, we don't, I can't read you that, but this is actually what do you call it, a picture of his return. It's a little bit, you know, premature to show it, but let's go to the next one. Okay, he, remember his vow to the king of Gaochang, that upon his return, he would go to Gaochang and spread Buddhism for 3 years. But by the time he crossed the mountain and get back to the desert, he received word that Gaochang was already gone, totally destroyed, that it just doesn't exist anymore.
It's a small country.
It's a small country, but it just doesn't didn't exist anymore. So he took the northern route to go to northern in reference to the desert. But and therefore he said, all right, so there's I don't have an obligation to fulfill anymore. So he took the southern route and went back to China. And before he went back, he wrote a letter to the emperor of China, apologizing for his taking a leave without the visa, you know, and by the time he got back, of course, the emperor, you know, welcomed him with, you know, a great parade. You can show that. I think that it was meant to. Ah, it's okay. It's all right. Yeah, we'll just. Okay. Now, we are getting to what we are supposed to be talking about. This is Asanga. This is the monk that established the foundation of Yogacara Buddhism. There is a Maitreya, who is a bodhisattva. can I have one of the handout sheets? Right, thank you, thank you. Okay, all right. One of the problem about reading, and I read in Chinese, most of the stuff came from Chinese descriptions. The Chinese translated it from Sanskrit. And then there's English translations. So it's very difficult to translate back and forth like that. But anyway, he is the one who you know, established that, and it's in Chinese translation it's called Gai Sammat Ging. Anyway,
Gai
Kid Gai. Gai
Sam Jehu Sam O Sam
Mat Jehu Pi Mat Gai.
It's not the this the heart?
No, it's not that. It's some is deep. Okay. Yeah, the sutra that.
And about the heart.
No.
Emotional.
Yeah, there is a heart sutra, but it's not that. The heart sutra actually goes before Gaisama Geng, because heart sutra belongs to sort of like Nagarjuna's period, when he talked about sunyata mostly. But by the time you get to Asanga, which is a few hundred years later, they were establishing the system much more tightly to explain the phenomenon of sunyata, etc. Okay, can we go to the next one? I said that Asanga established the foundation of Yogacara Buddhism. And this is his brother, Vasubandhu, who is quite a few years younger than he was. And he's the one who popularized the Yogacara Buddhism. And before he died, he wrote a short you know, 30 stanzas as Vijnaptimatratasiddhi-Trimsika. I hope I pronounce it right. And so it's 30 stanzas, and these 30 stanzas talked about the idea of Yogacara Buddhism. Yogacara Buddhism is translated as Wai Sik in Chinese. But Yogacara Wai is, it means somebody translate as merely Wai Hao Ji Bin Jiao Gai Wai as only consciousness or merely consciousness, etc. This is the whole 30 stanzas in Chinese. And at the back, you will see this is the whole 30 stanzas in, I think, Sanskrit. Okay, let's go to the next one. Ah, okay. Okay, we can go to the next one.
Not really, I'm trying to figure it out.
Well, at least put it on once at the right side here. Yeah.
Sorry? The other way.
Ah, the other way, of course. No. No. It's this way. This is the right way, right?
No, the line should be on top.
Yeah.
That's right.
Okay, all right, okay, all right. Thank you. By the way, Sanskrit is one of the most complicated language in the world. It really is, it's so precise, it's incredible. I won't go into that, but basically it is extremely precise.
More so than
French? Oh, much, much more so. Much more so.
Just 1 second, Dr. It's the same problem when it comes to translations. It's like translating Chinese to English. This little Sanskrit will be this long English. So it's very tough.
Exactly.
Yeah, those words don't exist in other languages. You gave birth to languages, Chinese from here and Sanskrit from there.
Right.
And then came Greek and Latin, breaking off from them.
Right.
So because that's why Sanskrit is called an Indo-European language.
That's right. Interesting. We should really, you know, I wish one day we can really talk about that, because I'm fascinated by the, you know, the development of language and how it transmitted itself, you know, between India and Europe, you know, etc. But just to show you what you're talking about, you only have one page for the 30 stanzas. The translation in English takes about 11 pages. So, yeah. And also, you know, a word on the translation. You know, Tibetan language is modeled itself after Sanskrit. And so when Buddhism was transferred to Tibet, a lot of the scriptures were translated into Tibetan language. But because of the relationship, so it is relatively easy to return, translate from existing Tibetan Buddhist scriptures back into Sanskrit. But it is almost impossible to try to do some backward translation from Chinese into Sanskrit. It just is not possible. Well, I shouldn't say not possible. It's very, very difficult. Anyway, somebody was asking me, he said, well, look, you know, you're going to be talking about Yogacara Buddhism, but well, you know, I really want to know some basics. What exactly is Buddhism? So I try to start from there. Buddhism, you know, basically if you go to any monastery, Buddhist monastery, if you ask anybody, they, you know, what is Buddhism? This is exactly what they will tell you. And the translation goes somewhere like that. Right? Basically, stay away from the evil deeds, follow the good behavior, purify your own thoughts, etc. Now, what are the evil deeds? What are the evil deeds? What are the, you know, this, right? It's basically greed. It's not exactly just greed, you know, anger and ignorance. Okay.
It's more
of
obsession.
That's. Yeah, it's obsession.
It's like,
yeah.
Like some people, they're just all about money, you know.
Right. It's obsession is a good word, a good way of conveying what it means, but. The obsession is because of your ignorance of the true way, let's say, and so you are obsessed. And so good deeds are, you know, following the discipline, be able to calm yourself down, etc., and be able to get some wisdom. So what are the things about purifying your own thoughts? This is important because we'll be talking about this a little bit later. This, or your thoughts, or you can be translated as your mind. All right? Purify your own mind. Purify your mind of what? Right? Purify your mind of the self, the ego. Okay? Here it says the self, and this is other than self, the two things that we adhere ourselves to. And basically, this just means ego. You know, if you're egocentric, if everything gets to around the ego, if you can let go of your ego, basically, that's what it means. Then you're following Buddhism. Buddhism puts a lot of effort in the ego, in terms of, say, trying to break that. And the good things that, you know, we do besides this, basically, you know, these are the six different modalities, you know, that you have to, you know, you have to follow the discipline. You should, you know, be generous. You should withstand. How do you say that? Humiliation. Be humiliated. You know, when you're humiliated, you know, meditation, you know, basically work hard and to achieve wisdom. Let's go. So these are, I mean, that's what basically what Buddhism is. Buddhism does not talk about God. Buddhism does not talk about Buddha as a God. It came probably much, much later when you talk about that. The idea of Buddhism started from Buddha, Sakyamuni. Basically, it was about causal relationships, that people, you know, things happen because of one thing leads to another. And to understand how one thing leads to another is the whole idea. And I think in Sanskrit it's pratitya samupada. And that is basically what Buddha was always talking about. There's no mentioning of God at that time.
Can I just ask a question? Why, as Chinese, is there all these gods like Guanyin and all these like other gods that are supposedly, I think it has become indigenized, that is incorporated other, you know, into the Buddhism, has, I think that's the large appeal to it, that it has become in some ways Chinese.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's interesting because you know, Guan Yin, or when she was in India, she was a man. But when but because of it, the nature of compassion, fits in better with a female figure. So by the time it came to China, they changed the sex of you know, Guan Yin into a female. Well, that's not what Buddhism trying to do, trying to change. But Buddhism is interesting in the sense that we also, when we are, you know, trying to say, oh, well, we want to learn about Buddhism, and don't, what can you expect from Buddhism? Buddhism never talks about the changing of the socio-economic system. It doesn't talk about the changing of the material world, nor does it even talk about the changing of the physical body, meaning that if you are sick or something, they'll make you feel better. Even though within the Buddhist studies, there are studies about medicine, there are studies about engineering, there are studies about all of that. But the crust of Buddhism is not that. The central point of Buddhism is the changing of people's minds. Okay.
If you change people's mind, doesn't it also change the physical relationship, the social,
Exactly.
Once you change the mind, how people think, like if people don't always think about happiness and profit, but try to help people, you know, if you change the social economics, you change the material world, people who are rich are willing to, you know, pay their workers a decent wage so they won't be starving.
Okay. That's very good. I thought that you set the central theme of the talk, and that is, if you change people's minds, you are actually changing reality, and which is what you know, Yogacara Buddhism is trying to say. One more point about what I just said about changing people's mind. It's basically it's personal liberation. You know, if people feel, for example, you know, when you feel angry, when you feel depressed, when you feel, you know, jealous or sad or this or that, and then finding yourself in a rut, you know, Buddhism, the study of that can help.
It's actually, just to continue the sentence, is change of one's mind and giving you freedom to do so, and you get out of the rut. The translation from Pali this time, not from Sanskrit, was man is man's own master. You have to find your own salvation by fighting through. You are in, you know, your mind is running all over, you have greed, you have anger, you control it, and you become your own master.
Very good.
Yeah, that's the important thing. And what you mentioned just now was about, I can't remember just now what you said.
I was saying that if you change people's minds, then you change the physical reality.
Yeah,
people
yeah.
start changing their relationship with each other. They
that's right.
Make people more compassionate.
Yeah, yeah.
Instead of commodities.
Right. I think that you know, that's the basic idea of Yogacara Buddhism. This is sort of like a time frame of the so-called development of Buddhism. This is about 500 years BC, okay? That's when the Buddha was born and talked about, you know, pratitya samuppada, basically how, why is it that we suffer? How did we suffer? How did we suffer? How can we get rid of the suffering? And how did we can we achieve peace? Basically, he talks all about that, and based all of that on how everything causal, that there is a cause, the suffering has a cause. And when you're able to deal, work with the cause, then you will reduce your suffering and eliminate your suffering. That's the way he taught. But by the time it gets to Nagarjuna, things began to change, where people began to talk more about the concept of so-called emptiness. Sunyata probably is a better term, because when you say emptiness, sometimes it conveys a wrong image. What you're talking about is basically the impermanence of things, and therefore the unreality of that self. What you consider to be so solid, so permanent, so real, in fact, is just constructed. And so, and this is Nagarjuna, and this is before Asanga and Vasubandhu, which came roughly about 200 years later. And then a few, couple of hundred years, you know, Hsuan Tsang came along. Buddhism transmitted into China around zero year, when Christ was born around that time. Okay, and by the time that 1200 comes around, Buddhism ended in India. The reason that it ended, there's all kinds of reasons that it ended, but we won't go into that. So, next slide, please. Okay. This, in a nutshell, is what Yogacara Buddhism is. I was trying to look for this, the translation is Samdhi Nirmokkhana Sutra by Maitreya. Maitreya is the, one of the bodhisattvas who, now usually sutra, you know, it's the words by the Buddha, but sometimes, you know, words by Maitreya, by the bodhisattva can also be called sutra. But in any case, this sutra was either written by Maitreya or written, by Asanga, you know, collected it down. But it's based on some sort of a conversation between Maitreya and the Buddha. And then it's recorded, and that is the Samdhinirmokkhana Sutra, which was a very important sutra in the understanding of Yogacara Buddhism. This is the Chinese term. And what it says is, you know, very simple. This is wrong. This should be this. This is not, this should be consciousness. That which consciousness clings on to is itself a manifestation of consciousness. Okay? This sick is should be this sick.
Yes. That other one actually means a different meaning, it's opposite meaning, right?
Yeah. Because you need consciousness to cling on to something. And so this is actually this. This is the word for it. Okay? That is basically, what it is. I should write this. Okay. Take a look at the next slide. This is very similar to what Hsuan Tsang wrote, right? Because what we agreed as object is inseparable from I consciousness. In that sutra, it says what consciousness clings onto is manifested by consciousness. In other words, you know, they are the same kind of things, different manifestations. Okay, can we go to the next one? With one exception. One exception is the premise presented by Hsuan Tsang is much more limited than what was being presented by the sutra. The sutra said, whatever consciousness clings on to is manifested by consciousness. Whereas Hsuan Tsang is much more conservative. Maybe there's a reason for that, because at that time in India, if you lose a debate, the price that you pay is your head. And so you really want to make sure that you don't get, you protect yourself in all the arguments so that you are not going to lose. So maybe that's a reason why he, you know, contracted his, turf, in so to speak, in terms of, say, what he presents. Okay, this is basically the first stanza in the 30 stanza. Okay. Now, let's go to the next one. Basically, what it says is this: is that. Yeah, I think so. Oh, this I don't think I don't think you do. It should be the first one right here. It should be the first one right here. Oh, the Chinese would be the on the right hand side, the first line on the right hand side. This one, I don't think you do.
No,
you don't have this one. What they are talking about is about consciousness. Is that the world that we know is consists of the self and everything else that around the self. And all of that are just images which changes as our consciousness change. And the kind of consciousness can be divided into three kinds. And these are the three kinds of consciousness that we talked about. Now, consciousness, generally, you know, we are, you know, our eye consciousness, our ears, our smell, our taste, our feel, and our mind. These are the different kinds of sensory consciousness. Now, Yogacara Buddhists introduce two more consciousness, manas and alaya. Alaya is the most fundamental kind of consciousness. It's like the example that they chose is that it's like torrents of water, that it changes constantly. Imagine yourself at the Niagara Falls, and when you look at the water, it does not stay the same. It's changing all the time. On the other hand, the alaya consciousness is also illustrated by the great earth, that it contains and, you know, and has all the seeds, so that the seeds can blossom into fruits and, you know, stuff like that. And it is this alaya consciousness that it's from there that we get all the different things. Now, let me say a few words about manas. Manas is part of consciousness, but it's a consciousness that is focused on the self and the ego. And the job is of manas is constantly calculating. In whatever situation you have, it will calculate. And the calculation is based on the self. Is it good for me? Is it not good for me? Is it, do I like it? Do I not like it? Is it agree? Does it agree to what I think? Does it not agree to what I think? It's constantly discriminating and judging.
So it's the ego, right? It tries to harmonize the relationship.
Right, right. It kind of translates into the ego structure, I guess. I'm not a psychologist, so I'm not going to be able to talk about that. But basically, it has a lot to do with the structure of the psyche, for example. I think that Freud, as well as Jung, did, you know, use quite a bit of this of the discussions that's contained in these. Okay, let's go to the next one.
Can I just ask you a question?
Okay, sure.
It says you're focusing on the self and the ego, and the self is always constantly calculating. So is it something that in the capitalist system, this part of the self becomes magnified because you're always thinking, how much money am I getting paid for the work? And in some ways, isn't it, you know, there's more of an emphasis on that.
Yeah.
Just money.
Yeah, it's not just money. It's like, oh,
everything.
Yeah, it's right. It's
yeah.
Yeah, it's do I like it? Is it good for me? Is
it more about me rather than
it's totally about me. It is totally about me. And also, for example, I have a concept: what is right and what is wrong. So even behavior, that moral codes that we think, how can it be wrong? Well, that is a concept. It's a concept that is, if you cling on to it too tightly, that it may bring you and everybody else, you know, bad consequences. In other words, it's trying to say that you cannot cling on to something and thinking that it may be so right, so sacred, that it cannot be questioned, because they are structured, they're constructed. That's the idea. And they're usually constructed by the self. If you accept it, you examine on the pros and cons and you accepted it. So this is my code of behavior. That code of behavior itself is can be questioned. And you know, that's basically what it's trying to say. So, you know, he's saying that what you call a saint, what you call a sinner, all of that are the changing of the consciousness. And consciousness, you know, when it changes into perception and the object of perception. Now, what do I mean by that? I tell you what. We'll read this first. I hope that I have a slide that explains this. And so, Atman is basically self, all right? And Dhammas is basically what I said, you know, concept, things, everything that is not so-called self. Right, or things, you know, or, you know, my body, etc. You know, self doesn't just mean, you know. So, it is saying that because all of this is coming from consciousness and the changing of the consciousness, and therefore, because of that fact, the self and the Dharma, they are not permanent. They are not fixed. They are not unchangeable. They are not, quote, real.
Isn't like the word you use in Chinese, like nothingness?
You see, sometimes we are, my experience is that when I was reading, especially Chinese, sometimes I get kind of distracted by words like this. When you translate this to mean emptiness, means non-existence and stuff like that, it gets into a different kind of a problem. But it doesn't really mean non-existent. It just means that it's not solid. It's not fixed. It changes all the time.
So it's more than 某影态.
I would not say 某影态. I would say that 某相. They are not constant.
Things are not constant.
Yeah, they are not constant. They're changing all the time. And because of that, we say it's all consciousness. Let's go. Let's go to the next one. I hope I have something. Because, yeah, good. Now with this, it says that consciousness, sense organ, environment. Well, generally we say we need our sense organ to find out what's happening around us, and therefore we develop a consciousness, right? Our eye see this, so we know it's there. Our eye differentiates, and we find out what is there. And so it became a part of our consciousness. But consciousness also changes the sense organs and the environment. And this is what you talked about, Don, right? And that consciousness, how does the consciousness change the sense organ? Because the sense organ needs development to be able to see. I think that Piaget talks about those things. How children, you're not born into something and then you immediately see everything. It took a long time for the baby in order to perceive what's out there. You know, the distinguishing, for example, the subject from the background took a long time for the babies, to do that. And now, so this is basically saying that the sense organ, the environment, they are all coming from the changing of the consciousness. Is there a question about that? Do you want to ask a question about that? Because what it talked about before in that stanza is saying that that which differentiates and that which is differentiated, essentially the environment and the sense organ, they are a result of the changing of the consciousness. I hate to use this example, but it's a vulgar example. Somebody from, say, really rural areas, when they come to New York, let's say, they never used a toilet before, they may think that the water is actually good for drinking because it looks so clean and everything. But, and therefore the sense organ and the environment are different because of the consciousness is different. When you realize that that is not what it's supposed to be, then the environment changes as well as your sense organ because your ability to differentiate changes. So the consciousness affects your ability to sense. When the consciousness change and your ability to differentiate changes, everything changes. So what am I trying to say here? Basically, consciousness affects this and affects that. Can we go to the next one? Okay, this is sort of like summarizing a little bit. The universe, the whole universe, your universe, is made out of the self and everything else. They're different kind of images. What does that mean? That means somebody is pretty, somebody is desirable, etc. They changes all the time. They change as your consciousness change. Somebody is desirable can become undesirable when your consciousness change. Let's go to the next one.
Can you explain the question about other than self?
Other than self means everything else. Like I want to say Dharma. The so-called Dharma means, for example, you know, you are self, this is something else, right? The room is something else, the light is something else, you are in the middle of Times Square, etc.
The translation of Dharma?
That would be, yeah, that you can translate that as Dharma, that is everything else. Okay. Now, this is an important stanza which tries to explain how the consciousness change. And it goes from that, you know, from the alaya consciousness, it goes to this, from the seed, it manifests itself, and then it changes, and then that's why all the differences came about. Let's go to the next one. Okay, there are three stanzas that I thought are quite important because that explains how it works, and this is another one. This one describes how consciousness change. It also talks about, you can also look at it as an explanation of samsara, how one life leads to another, and the fact that they change and the one leads to another is because of the actions that you have done and the so-called habitual energy. It's sort of like a momentum. If you're going straight in this way, a fast car, it takes time for it to stop. Even if you want to stop, it cannot stop right away. It takes time. And because of that, we call it the habitual energy. All right?
Is this energy throughout the heaven and earth?
No. It's energy, for example, if I'm very greedy, and then I realize that it's no good, and I try not to be greedy. But then the next time I see somebody dropped $100 bill, I may just go and take it, right?
Because it's like it becomes a part of habit.
Right, because even though you don't want to do it, you promise yourself that you don't want to be greedy anymore, right? But you would pick it up, right? And then this is important because it talks about not only that, not only about your action, what you have done, and about this habitual energy, but also about the ego, about the self, how you hang on to that, how you hang on to yourself, how you hang on to the so-called Dharma, which means your concept of what is good, what is bad, etc. Because of these, that's why when one life ends, enters another life, it maintains this kind of things. Because this, the habitual energy, the karma that is result of that, the ego adhesion, etc., mixes it, the links from one life to another. Let's go to the next one.
Is this about reincarnation?
Good point. Now, samsara usually is, you look at samsara as a reincarnation from one life to another. Now, I have problems with the reincarnation. It's my consciousness, I just find it difficult to really really accept it in a sense. But I think it doesn't have to be that way. It's the same thing when you talk about the relationship. First, I think there is time. Then there is a, I like to think of it as relationship, let's say. So whatever they talk about from one life to another and how it hangs on, etc., look at it like relationships. And the most common relationship would be with your husband, your wife, your girlfriend, your boyfriend, etc., when you enter into a relationship. And what we talked about, the karma, the habitual energy, the adhesion of the self, of dharma, etc., how you hold on to your concept of self, hold on to your concept of what is right, what is wrong, what is appropriate, what is not, etc., that will determine how your next relationship is going to be.
It's been said that Buddha never mentioned about rebirth the way the Hindus mention that you are in this samsara, being born again and again and again. Mm-hmm. But Buddha had mentioned, this is what I learned as a child, that we, because of our claim for our egos and our greed and other things, there is a loss and there is a win. The loss is the death. So in our lives, every day, throughout our lives, we die and we are born. Death is that loss.
That's a very, very good point.
That's what I learned.
Yes.
And the whole idea of rebirth came to Buddhism, reincarnation, from Hinduism. Yeah. Hindus dearly believed it. Mm-hmm. And when Buddhist texts were written about 500-600 years after Buddha's death, around that time, then this somehow crept into Buddhist texts.
Right.
That's what it's been said.
Yes.
I believe in that part. Right. Not in the reincarnation.
Okay. Thanks for your comments. I think that you mentioned about, Harold mentioned a very important point, and that is, at every instant, you mentioned day, but in fact, the Buddhists believe that at every instant, you die and you are reborn. You die and you're reborn. Meaning that, and therefore, in that sense, there's a continuous changes. Going along. And I'm glad that you talked about the influence of Hinduism on Buddhism, the development of it. Because as I was reading the Agama Sutra, I find that they didn't really talk that much about reincarnation. Agama Sutra was collected 100 years after the death of Buddha. And so that was probably the closest that anybody can get to what exactly Buddha has said. And in that sutra, very, very little is talked, is strictly on reincarnation. But they did talk about how difficult it is to be a human being so that you can understand what is going on, etc. Anyway, as we look at samsara, as we look at relationship, as we look at relationship going from one relationship to another, and I said that I used companion. The same thing can be say relationship of a job. When you go from one job to another job, right? What you go into this job with, and what you go into the other job with. If you don't change, then the relationship will pretty much probably be approximately the same. In other words, I think that what this is saying is that when you go to another relationship, you carry what you have from before to the new relationship.
So it's kind of like a baggage.
Yes.
you don't come to it here or empty or whatever, you already have these.
Exactly.
You already have these assumptions. So when you're arguing with someone, you feel frustrated because, you know, you already think, all right, this is my way, this is my dharma, your way is wrong.
Right. You cannot go into another relationship as a newborn baby. It's impossible. Because you have all this so-called baggage that you have. All the things that you have done, all the things that, your so-called habitual energy. Let's say that you like to fool around. You go to a new relationship that even though you promise yourself, no, I will never do that again. Well, your energy, carry yourself to it. So, you know, this relationship is also contaminated, etc. So basically that's what it's saying. and therefore consciousness at, you know, one and consciousness two at different times, you know, changes. You know, for example, in the relationship, as we go from one to the other, you know, the consciousness, you know, changes, and it determines that. Okay, so the question becomes, how do we change consciousness? When we go from one relationship to another relationship, or one life to another life, if you believe in reincarnation, yeah, how do we do that? How do we change the consciousness? Well, I put down here two things, that you need understanding and you need practice. Ah. We forgot to show our...
Is it in there?
Okay, let me do this first. Understanding, and we need practice. I put down practice to be meditation, samadhi, and vipassana. Meditation, this is very, you know, it means you calm yourself down, it focuses your thoughts, your mind, and then you begin to observe yourself, anything, you know, that is how you practice. But changing consciousness can also include things that we have talked about at the beginning, about what are the good things about Buddhism, and we talked about discipline, meaning that you don't break all the moral behavior codes, etc. You know, to be generous, to be tolerant, you know, that sort of thing. All of that will help the changing of the consciousness. And I say here, we need understanding and we need meditation. Meditation, I have vipassana. I've gone through vipassana meditation for 10 days. And for 10 days, you don't do anything but meditate, eat, and sleep. You're not allowed to speak. And to not speak for 10 days is an incredible experience. And for some of us anyway, you know, it's quite a pleasure to be able to not speak for 10 whole days. No eye contact with people. So you just basically focus on your own self. Can we have a quick...
Push play.
Just push play?
On the left side.
Left side. Here?
Yes.
Okay. This is a clip.
Do we have a deal?
Where's this from?
Matrix.
Matrix.
Oh. Can you see it?
Yes.
The volume's at the top.
Matrix is telling my brain that it is.
Click TV video.
I don't know what to do. Okay. It's a very short one. It's a very short one.
Then we have a deal.
Okay, it's from the Matrix.
Can we go back?
uh, uh, Can you do it? I just felt that I want to include that because back a little bit more. This is a person in the movie called Matrix who get enlightened, who I think he took the blue pill and so he's supposed to be enlightened. Okay, this is good.
Do we have a deal, Mr. Raven?
I know this steak doesn't exist. I know that when I put it in my mouth, the matrix is telling my brain that it is juicy and delicious. After 9 years, you know what I realize? Ignorance is bliss.
Okay, then he made a deal with this Agent Smith, and then he betrayed his colleagues, his friends. So what I'm trying to point this out is that enlightened, you know, I mean, knowing, understanding something, that this works and that doesn't work, let's say, is one thing. But without practice, it could lead to different kind of problems. And so I just thought of that clip and I thought I would show it to you. So what is this understanding? Can we go to the next slide? Oh, my goodness. Okay. Okay, maybe before we go to that one, let's take a look at this one. Okay, before we go to that one, it was just a sort of like an illustration. I'll quickly go over this. This is the Alaya consciousness. And it says that within the Alaya consciousness, there are all kinds of seeds. Innumerable seeds. Seeds are sort of like things that you have done, things that you have inherited, etc. If you water it, for example, that seed will grow. If you ignore it, the seed will die. So different seeds need different kinds of nurturing in order for it to blossom and develop. Some seeds are good, some seeds are, quote, not so good. And so how do you, and in the Alaya consciousness, it has all of that. And part of the consciousness, the manas consciousness, based on the ego and the self, it begins to hang on to those things, thinking that some is good, some is desirable, some is not desirable, and you try to avoid. And so how does... this is sort of like trying to understand how consciousness change. Seeds, they can manifest itself. Meaning that, for example, my hand, it doesn't have anything over there. But it doesn't mean that I cannot play violin, for example. Maybe I can, And so the latency is that ability to play violin. When I do play violin, it will be the manifestation of it, right? So the seeds will sometimes manifest itself, sometimes doesn't. And when it manifests itself, it will affect the next seed. We talked about how every instant things are dying and things are growing. And so you manifest and then you affect the next seed. And that's how things change. And then I try to say, sort of like summarize, and try to illustrate some of the connections between all these different things that we talked about. The seeds, the ego, and the consciousness. And I try to inspired by Rishi Raj, I tried to develop this. Remember what we talked about, the samsara, how in the flow of life, from one relationship to another, from one consciousness to another, even from one life to another, right? At a certain moment, called K, the consciousness at that moment, now I don't know if it really equals, but it certainly, you know, what the whole stanzas are talking about, is say that it's related to the person's accumulated karma, the things that he has done, the actions, up till the point K, and his modus operandi. I call that modus operandi to mean the so-called habit energy. This is the way I work. Whenever I get an insult, my reaction is that I'll fight back 10 times harder. That's a habit energy.
That's a strategy.
Right, that's the way I'm trained, how I am used to. That's the habit energy, that's my modus operandi, right? At that moment, K, and his ego level at K. I'm trying to summarize this. I may be committing great sins right now, but I'm trying to understand, trying to say, well, if I want to put it in some sort of a relationship, it may be stated this way. And so, these are the different actions. These are all the different actions, different seeds, etc. And this, I call it the habit energy, as a function. And a function, a simple one, can be, for example, it can be equal to x is a function, right? If z is equal to x, right? That's a function, right? Z is equal to x squared. That's another function. Z equal to x cubed. That's still another function. But it means different things because the strength of this depends on how that function is. X cubed is much stronger than x, for example, right?
Like accumulation
and also the kind of habit energy. If I'm only an X level and you are on an X cube, before I blow up, you're going to blow up way before I blow up, right? And so I'm saying that, and this is basically all the seeds, innumerable, infinite number of seeds. Infinite number of energy level that associates with it, and all of that sum affects our consciousness at moment K. And I introduce also Y's of K to represent the so-called ego level, the strength that we hang on to the self, the ego, hang on to the concepts, hang on to the the way we operate. Now, if, and this sort of like try to put all of this, link it up a little bit. Now, if the ego level becomes zero, then this becomes zero. And that is basically what Yogacara Buddhism talks about. That's when you reach the ultimate truth. When, that is sunyata in that sense.
Is that the stage of enlightenment then?
When you have no ego.
Nirvana.
Nirvana is the stage of enlightenment.
Right. And the whole thing about Buddhism is trying to reduce this to zero. If you can reduce this to zero, then you would reach nirvana. Now, I put this together only last night. So I don't claim any, you know, completeness in this, but just to sort of like indicate to us about the relationship of some of these things. Can we go to the next one? I mention this because it's very important. In the 30 stanzas, this is what it says. As long as one places something before himself and taking it as an object, declares that it is the nature of mere consciousness, he is really not residing in a state of mere consciousness because he is in possession of something. If we think, if I ever really have the audacity to think that that formula represents, you know, mere consciousness, right? Represents Yogacara idea. Because I have something, I cling on to something, that formula is that little something, then you are not really residing in the state of Yogacara Buddhism. You are not there yet because you are clinging on to something. So with that, I think that I'm going to stop. And if you can just very quickly put the rest up. In preparation for this, I have read a few books, and I really don't claim to be I basically just want to share with you some of the things that I have read. And I would definitely recommend this book to you. It's called Transformation at the Base, 50 Verses on the Nature of Consciousness. And it's Thich Nhat Hanh who wrote it. He's a Vietnamese who lived in Paris. Sometimes he comes over to the States, and he works with prisoners in prison, and he works with them. Now, Transformation, the 50 verses is important because Vasubandhu wrote two books. One is the 20 verses on consciousness. The other one is 30 verses on consciousness. He basically combined the two and also incorporated many different ideas. But the way he talks about it is very easy to understand. I tell you, there are many books are really tough. Before you go to the first, finish with the first chapter, you're totally lost. But this is a very good book for those who are interested in finding out what is Vijnaptimatratasiddhi, consciousness. This is a good book to get into. Okay, let's go to the next one. Okay, and basically this one is just some of the books that I've read in Chinese, and it's mostly in Chinese that I read. And if it is in Chinese, I would recommend one book which is not here. And that book is by Reverend Tai Xu.
Can you write it on the floor, please? It's an excellent book. Reverend Tang.